legislature's tourism caucus. I know that. So if you can, talk a little bit about Connecticut's tourism industry, and because I know it's taken a big hit. What are we doing, though, for this year to be more proactive and get people, particularly around our Connecticut shoreline, which is very, very beautiful?
Yeah, well, there's, you know, hundreds of thousands of jobs that are promoted by tourism, tax revenue, you know, over $15 billion in sales generate, you know, $2 billion in tax revenue throughout the state. Every dollar invested by the state in tourism generates three back. So tourism is an investment in the state, just like supporting manufacturing or small business or any other opportunity that's going to create jobs and support the revenue stream that the government needs. And we, some years ago, put together, I think you may have been in the legislature when that happened, we put together the tourism fund, which was generated from 10% of the hotel tax. And, you know, that got up to about $13, $14 billion.
Mm-hmm.
Part of that money, you know, $4 or $5 million, went to generate statewide marketing opportunities so we can advertise in, you know, surrounding states, Boston, New York, Albany, Philadelphia, Providence, to try to get people to come into Connecticut and see what we have to offer. Because, you know, in every corner of our state, there's some opportunity for tourism,
sure,
for arts, for culture. And we got to show that off and generate that revenue. And that's what's, you know, that's what we're doing. So now with the pandemic and the hotel industry suffering, the hospitality industry suffering, restaurants, you know, over 600 have closed in the state over the course of the pandemic.
Mm.
That tourism fund is less than half. So, you know, we're having conversations, you know, talking to people like Senator Austin, who co-chairs the Appropriations Committee, about, you know, finding a way to take some of this projected surplus we might have, perhaps some of the money that's generated if online gaming gets put in, and kick that back in to raise the bar on tourism. And because we know it's an investment and the money's generated help to pay for other programs that aren't revenue generating,
yeah,
that the state must need to support those most vulnerable.
I love going to Mystic. When my family and I, we take a couple of two or three trips a year into Mystic. We absolutely love it there. We're talking with State Senator Paul Formica. Paul, let's talk health for just a quick moment. I know you proposed a bill to allow people to have a medical test completed free of charge that would detect the presence of calcium containing plaque in the heart. That plaque, that makes a person at a higher risk for a heart attack. Am I mistaken, or is that true?
No, that's true. The plaque is what causes blockages, and, you know, you go in there and have the opportunity to get a stent put in or a bypass. That's all reasons, all done because of the plaque involvement. And this test, you know, kind of takes a picture of it and, you know, lets people know whether they're, you know, whether they have the opportunity to, you know, to have this build up and give them time to do something about it.
Good.
Or not. And, you know, something very near and dear to me, as you may remember, I lost my wife of almost 30 years at a very young age due to sudden cardiac event. And so we testified on this bill last year, and it stopped because of the, you know, because of the session was cut short. But, you know, we're hoping that, you know, this test, it's a simple test, and it goes to the basic premise that, you know, Republicans have been talking about, and that's, let's invest our money in health care, not sick care,
yeah,
because it's less expensive. And that's part of it. The cheap test could save a lot of money in terms of treatment,
mm-hmm,
but a whole heck of a lot of heartache, too.
I know you testified recently in favor of bills that came before the Aging Committee, a committee that I used to be ranking member on. Those bills would help improve the quality of life for vulnerable seniors, I know, by increasing the personal needs allowance to help people, I guess, age in place, right? While by staying in their homes rather than going to a nursing home or some type of senior living facility or institution. Talk about why, for you, that's a priority, and why the Senate Republicans in particular have gotten behind this bill.
Well, you know, we are putting together a program as we're rolling out as the session gets going that we call a better way. And we think a better way that 90% of seniors agree on is, you know, spending time at home as much time as they can and, you know, being at home as often as they can. And programs like Meals on Wheels, right. You know, like the personal tax deduction that we proposed, you know, which will help people stay at home, you know, an opportunity to expand social services so that the DSS could support more home related services and like the Alzheimer respite care. Those are things that will help people get home, stay home. And at the end of the day, we believe it'll cost the state less money in the long run, you know, to provide these services instead of paying out of, you know, Medicaid and other opportunities in the budget. So, you know, we think that's important. And I think people in Connecticut agree with that.
No, just listening to you is music to my ears. I always have a soft spot for our most vulnerable, and in particularly those with intellectual and developmental disabilities and our senior citizens. I really do believe it's our job as elected officials to really give a voice to those who have none and to really fight for those who cannot fight for themselves. I want to talk to you about something really quickly. I know we only have a couple of minutes remaining. It had to do with last week. The legislature's rules process was rather controversial. If you remember, the Democrats, you know, they're in majority, so they make the rules. 2 weeks ago, they ruled that a committee hearing on the religious exemption for immunization would have a 24-hour time limit. Well, that rule is essentially silenced, really has silenced the voices of more than 1,500 people because they were lined up waiting to testify virtually on that bill. But once the 24 hours was up, they couldn't speak. Now, fast forward to this past Friday. There was a marathon public hearing on assisted suicide, but no time limit was imposed on that hearing. The rules just changed based on whatever the majority Democrats feels, right? I mean, if we're going to have rules, let's have continuity rules. Let's have uniform rules, not pick and choose which rules apply to what committee. Your take on it.
Yeah, and one of the things that, you know, that we've talked about is the problem with this online session is that it disables some people's right to be heard. And this is the people's house. And when you have, I think it was over 1,900 people signed up for that hearing on the vaccine exemption, and 250 spoke. And, you know, what happens to those other voices? And if, you know, if one party or another disagrees with the majority of the voices, that still shouldn't allow them the latitude to say, well, we're just not going to hear you. You know, part of being a public servant is sitting there listening. You know, you've been there.
Oh, yeah.
It's long sometimes, but, you know, that's what we're there for. And when we hear all voices, you know, all the time, and, you know, we can't just pick and choose, you know, the issues that we're in favor of, and we'll say, okay, let's have everybody talk about that, but the ones that we're not, let's not. So, you know, that's something that needs to be worked out. And My understanding is the chairs of each of those committees are given that kind of latitude to make those decisions.
No, but that's I always thought that there were uniformed rules. I'm running out of time. Listen, Paul, we've got to have you on more often, Senator. You are always a phenomenal interview, and I look forward to having that sooner rather than later.
My pleasure. Thanks for having us, and good luck in what you're doing.
Good luck with what you're doing. I think you'll need more of it. Your phone calls are next.